Technology.
It shapes
and reshapes our world.
The hardware and the software
make us aware of better ways of doing things.
For work or for leisure, technology can improve our lives
and re-energize our lifestyles.
We can create it
or we can adapt it.
The technology of the present can help us prepare
for a future perfect.
Hi, I'm Tony Velasquez. In early December last year, while most Pinoys were busy buying gifts and preparing for their Christmas parties, the notorious hacker collective Anonymous posted something on YouTube that barely went noticed. Anonymous was warning about the dangers of something called SOPA, or the Stop Online Piracy Act. Now, fast forward 1 month, and it seems the entire web is now aware of the far-reaching law enough to rally netizens in a massive day of internet activism.
Citizens of the United States, we are Anonymous. There is a new bill that the United States government is trying to pass. It is called the Stop Online Piracy Act, or SOPA, for short, also known as the Protect IP Act of 2011. The U.S. Congressional Budget Office estimated that implementation of the bill would cost the federal government $47 million through 2016. Translated into plain English, it will cost taxpayers $47 million. The SOPA Act will censor you from accessing certain websites and block all access to other areas of the internet that the United States government does not want you to access. The SOPA Act essentially means that even if you make a video of your child playing or singing and you have music playing in the background, or video on TV, you are breaking the law, and the government will order the websites that host your content to censor your content because of their new bill. Or if you visit websites that are on servers not in the United States, you will be blocked so that you cannot access them. Ask yourselves, who really owns the internet? Or type it into Google. The answer is simple. No one actually owns the internet. And no single person, organization, or government controls the internet in its entirety.
Last January 18, Pinoy netizens woke up to what SOPA was all about. Some of the net's most popular sites went on a blackout in protest of SOPA and its cousin PIPA, or the Protect Intellectual Property Act. Wikipedia went dark, as did Reddit, while Wire.com posted what looked like a censored web page to show their opposition to SOPA. Internet heavyweights Google, Facebook, Yahoo also put up links directing users to pages that explained why they are against SOPA and PIPA. The websites of major music companies, the main backers of SOPA, as well as the U.S. government websites like the FBI and the U.S. Department of Justice also temporarily went down, but not because they were protesting SOPA, but because Anonymous staged attacks on these sites. Video game industry group ESA, or the Entertainment Software Association, was forced to withdraw its support for SOPA. The public backlash against SOPA and PIPA has apparently also succeeded in eroding political support for the bills. But as many observers note, this does not mean SOPA and PIPA won't surface again in some other form in the future.
And joining us on Future Perfect to tell us more about SOPA and PIPA and what they mean for Pinoy netizens is internet law expert, Attorney J.J. Dicini. Attorney J.J., thanks for coming back to the show.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
All right. The SOPA and PIPA, as to how they affect Philippine internet users, is there going to be much of an impact for us? Because we've seen what happened recently when authorities raided the house of the mega upload owner.
Uh-huh.
Arrested him and several of his officers, and then they confiscated their properties. Now, that's you're talking about the U.S. applying its laws outside of their territory.
That's correct. SOPA and PIPA, actually, initially, when they were considering it, was supposed to apply to all websites. Mm. And then at some time, when they saw there was a lot of opposition, and this was like maybe a month ago, the sponsor of the bill tried to craft an amendment where they said, well, they will only make it apply to sites outside the United States.
Okay.
So therefore, definitely this would affect sites in the Philippines. So let's take sites like, let's say, Ayos Dito or Sulit.com. Mm-hmm. Those are sites where, because the way SOPA and PIPA works, if there is some infringement that's happening, say some people are selling pirated goods, in some of the sites, the whole site will go down. Mm-hmm. So let's say you're selling your car, or maybe you're selling, you're a used car dealer and you're selling 10 cars and that's all legitimate, and that's your marketplace. Right. Suddenly your whole marketplace disappears.
So there's no warning even, or like a grace period that they call attention to the web administrator and say, oh, you have one vendor who's engaged in intellectual piracy, so I want you to take that out of your site. Wala man lang warning na ganun.
That's correct. Mm. In the way SOPA was drafted, the Attorney General of the U.S. just goes to a court and makes the application, and the site, the domain name will be revoked.
Yeah.
The payment providers will be told not to transact with that site. Mm-hmm. Internet advertising agencies will be told not to transact with that site. And then search engines will be also told to remove any search results involving that domain.
Good.
So imagine like Facebook. Mm. If somebody sold fake Louis Vuitton bags on Facebook, then on that basis, Facebook.com will disappear, and then everybody's Facebook accounts will disappear. It's to that effect.
And people do use Facebook now as an online marketplace. No?
Some people
there are some transactions that are being done there. There are Facebook marketers.
That's right.
Yeah. So it's possible. But you said, no? That only websites outside of the U.S. are actually covered.
Yes,
but
when Facebook, they amended. That's right.
But Facebook technically is incorporated in the U.S.
That's correct. It's incorporated in the U.S.
So hindi sila, they can't be touched yet.
They can't be touched. But the issue among the Americans is really a freedom of expression issue.
Yeah.
And certainly Facebook exemplifies that. Everybody who puts something on Facebook has a Facebook page. In effect, is expressing himself. Mm. And when one person or two or three people sell pirated goods, and then 500 million people's accounts are cut off, and all their data is stranded because the domain is inaccessible.
Right.
Then certainly their freedom, their right of to express themselves, the freedom of expression has been infringed.
Now, why do you suppose U.S. legislators have to come up with these two bills, SOPA and PIPA, when in fact they already have a lot of copyright laws, intellectual property laws, and they can seemingly apply these naman in other cases without resorting to such drastic measures?
Actually, back in the late 90s, there was the Digital Millennium Copyright Act. Mm. And under that law, if a service provider, let's say like Yahoo, Yahoo Mail, let's say people were using Yahoo Groups, for example, to distribute copies of the book by Harry Potter book, for example, right? Mm. So that would be infringement. Now, under the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, the copyright owner will send a notice to Yahoo, and then Yahoo has to take down that content.
Exactly.
So that's the only thing that the service provider has to do. The service provider can focus on his business, and if they're infringing things going on in his site, he will just take those down.
Okay.
Now, that balance is no longer acceptable to IP rights holders. It's not enough for them to just notify and take it down, because what they're seeing is that it's ineffective. So what they want are more drastic measures.
It's ineffective. They see it's ineffective.
They see it as ineffective and costly for them as well. Mm-hmm. So they've had to file lawsuits against some of these sites, and it's costing them money in the U.S. Mm-hmm. Having the Attorney General do the job for them is in effect a subsidy.
Uh-huh.
So to the extent that $47 million is being used of taxpayers' money to enforce private rights, that's the point of the law.
But there are a lot more in terms of dollar costs that are being lost because of piracy now. I mean, exactly just how much does the U.S. lose out to software piracy or to intellectual piracy?
Okay, the number is quite big, but I think you have to question whether or not the measurement is accurate. Because you can say, let's say you will go to a mall somewhere in Manila where they're selling fake DVDs, right? And you say you count the number of people walking out with the number of DVDs, and say you multiply that by the number of DVDs, that the price of the DVD, and you say that's the loss, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But actually, if those people were buying, if only legitimate DVDs were available at a much higher price, they wouldn't buy as many. And so the loss isn't really that much.
Okay.
There's a tendency on the part of copyright owners to overblow the estimates.
Pero wala namang kinikita yung copyright owner sa pirated, no? Even though sabihin mo na hindi naman, well, kumukonti yung bumibili ng mga original or yung copies, no? Pero wala namang napupuntang kita sa kanila if, you know, people buy
yes.
pirated.
Well, actually, the question there is that those people who bought pirated, would they have bought the legitimate if they had no choice?
Mm.
And the answer, I suppose, would be no.
Mm.
Right? There are a lot of people out there walking around with Louis Vuitton bags who would only buy the fake and not the original, because if the original, they couldn't afford it. And same is true for things like movies and music.
Mm.
And that's that. I think iTunes demonstrated that. When it got down to the point of 99 cents,
right.
people said, it's not no point downloading it off the web, I'll just buy it legitimately.
And now we have a local My Music store
right.
that's now offering also songs. For 33 pesos, I believe.
There you go.
So mas na ibababa nila yung presyo.
Yes, and it forced a change in the business model. It used to be that they'll sell you only 10 songs. The record company forces you to buy nine other songs you're not
but
interested
you
in, right? Now they'll retail to you at one per song.
Okay. Bumabalik tayo sa era nung yung 45.
That's right.
Yung single.
There you go. That's right. Pero yung dalawa yun, you know.
Oh yeah, pero actually yung usually yung side B hindi mo pinapakinggan,
that's
di ba?
Right, that's right.
Well, so It comes to mind, of course, syempre, na when you talk about piracy, well, the Philippines has a notorious record, di ba? Because hirap na nga yung optical media board, di ba?
That's right.
They raid all these places, pinapasara, nagko-confiscate, and yet, balik lang ng balik eh. Because kulang tayo sa enforcement lang ba, or do we need something as drastic like the SOPA and the PIPA locally?
Yeah. Well, enforcement of intellectual property rights is a privately driven process. In other words, the copyright owner or the intellectual property right holder must be the one to complain to the government. My analogy is, let's say that we know that 75% of all cars in Metro Manila are stolen.
Mm.
And you're a policeman, and you're standing in the corner of Quezon Avenue and EDSA, and you know that 75% of all the vehicles
the
you see
undone.
Are stolen. Mm. Question, can you stop anyone and say that's a stolen car?
Mm.
You can't do that unless the owner of the car tells you, that's my car, and
Ninaho.
It's stolen. Mm. So that's the same thing. So you can be a police officer in the middle of a place where you're selling fake DVDs, but unless somebody tells you, that's my DVD and I didn't license that, how can they act? So it's a chicken and egg situation where the copyright holders are complaining that there's piracy, but in order for there to be stricter enforcement, they have to initiate that enforcement.
Don't they?
Well, they do, but you know what? The Philippines has bent over backwards.
Mm.
We have intellectual property judges.
Mm.
We have intellectual property divisions in every major law enforcement agency.
Mm.
There's even intellectual property regulations at the local level.
Mm.
Recently, the Supreme Court enacted special rules for intellectual property rights. We have special rules for search and seizure intellectual property cases.
Mm-hmm.
There's so much that's been done by the Philippine government. Essentially, the Philippine government has built this big bazooka in favor of intellectual property rights owners. And it's really up to them to take it and pull the trigger. But
okay.
it costs them money to do that, and so they would rather that the government be the one to undertake that. So an entity like Optical Media Board is such a thing because it's funded by taxpayers, and it enforces essentially intellectual property rights.
Is litigation for an intellectual property case not a cut and dried thing? I mean, parang it's so easy to prove na hey, you stole my intellectual property, right? It's obvious that it's not licensed, so you can throw the book at whoever violates the law.
Okay, so it's interesting you said that because whatever difficulties IP rights holders had before in proving their case, the Supreme Court very recently enacted rules which made it very easy for them to prove intellectual property infringement.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, now, the evidence of good faith is not a defense for intellectual property infringement. So let's say I own a grocery and I have 10,000 items for sale. And it turns out that, let's say I bought this, let's say fake shoes.
Mm.
No, I had no idea I was buying from a legitimate source or what I thought was a legitimate source. It turns out it's fake Nikes.
Mm.
Okay?
Okay.
Now, under the law, I can go to jail. Under these new rules, I can go to jail and I cannot defend. I cannot say, I bought
faith.
It from a legitimate, I cannot have the defense of good faith. The Supreme Court took away that defense. So, it's actually quite an interesting regulation, and it just came out. And it's the sort of thing that will send people to jail.
Mm.
And in effect, if you're an IP rights holder, you can ask anything from any of these people whom you raid, because they are looking at jail time. Yeah. It's not just civil damage. So I think it's a situation now where I think the Supreme Court sort of crossed the line, and they're already tipping the scales in favor of IP rights holders.
Mm. Well, we saw the case against the PirateBay.org.
Yes.
The Swedish guys,
yes.
and that was actually being built up, you know, as an example, no,
yes.
For other parang mga websites that are offering file sharing,
right.
Peer-to-peer file sharing, no. But actually, torrents ang kanilang argument is you're not pirating it in essence, because you're actually just taking bits and pieces of the file
right.
from other people's computers.
Correct.
So
actually,
it's not
yes.
an entire product that you're getting off your yes. website.
Yes, actually, Pirate Bay is saying we're not distributing the files. It's people who are distributing the files.
Mm.
We're just a place where if you want to find people who are willing to share, you can find it here.
Yeah.
So they're not doing any distribution themselves.
Uh-huh.
They may be facilitating it in that sense.
So yung mga ganong organizations, hindi
yes.
sila pwedeng targetin ng SOPA or PIPA. In essence.
Well, actually, that would be the target of SOPA and PIPA.
Yeah.
But, you know, it goes again into the effectiveness. So let's say you take down PirateBay.org, right? So tomorrow it will come up as PirateBay.ru. So they just change their domain name, and then that's done. So in September of 2010, the U.S. government took down something like 8 or 10 domain names.
Uh-huh.
That's the first time that they actually seized domain names. And they said, so this site supposedly disappeared. And some of them were up within 24 hours. So business as usual, because the site isn't down. The resources are still there.
Uh-huh.
The servers are still there. In fact, even if you take down the domain name, the numeric number is still good. The
okay.
IP address
the IP
is still
address.
Good. So like
uh-huh.
122.126.3.4. So you can still go to the site.
So in DNS, they take that out, your IP
yes.
address is still there.
Your IP address is still good.
Mm-hmm.
So the site is still up. So all you need to do is get another domain name,
okay.
maybe in a country that doesn't, the U.S. doesn't control, like Russia,
mm-hmm.
and you get .ru. Right?
.ru.
Right?
Okay.
They don't care what the U.S. government does. They don't follow U.S. court orders.
Yeah.
And then the .ru will just say, okay, point, when you go to, what's this, PirateBay.ru, then
uh-huh.
you go to that site.
So doon pala marami magandang mga web addresses. Huh?
Well, it depends on, there's the relationship between the United States and the domain name system is a complex one.
Mm.
Because the domain name system is a critical infrastructure of the internet.
Right.
And the United States controls it.
Mm-hmm.
No other country. So the ITU tried to take control of it, and they could not. The U.S. government controls it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this legislation puts them at risk, because the reason why the DNS enjoys the good faith
mm-hmm.
among users is that the U.S. has acted responsibly.
Mm-hmm.
But if they're going to use the DNS as a way to enforce intellectual
as
property rights
ah.
as a weapon, then it might be, and this is sort of the extreme, that the internet might fork. Where other people might say, well, let's not use the DNS,
okay.
let's use something else. We'll develop our own infrastructure that cannot be controlled by anyone. It will
mm-hmm.
be running on servers all over the world with redundancies and whatever, no? You know what
it's
I'm talking
possible,
about?
Huh?
It's possible. So
yeah.
you just install a piece of software, you launch your own domain name system. It's an alternate, it's like a sort of an alternate universe.
Yes.
And then you can have things point to the same thing. You
mm-hmm.
just have this software running on machines.
Well, before we go to future scenarios and before we close, let's just go to one present-day scenario, and very quickly, I hope you can address this.
Mm-hmm.
It's in the tabloids. Somebody snapped a picture of a high-ranking government official supposedly in a mall somewhere in Metro Manila buying about 2,000 pesos worth of pirated DVDs. So this high-ranking government official hasn't given his side of the story yet. People, news organizations, even ours, have been trying to contact him. What do you think should happen? I mean, here's proof. Photograph.
Uh-huh.
He's in a mall. He's buying pirated DVDs, and may amount pa, no? Sinabi siguro ng tindero magkano binili. What's gonna happen to somebody like that?
Well, it's not a crime to buy
pirated DVDs. Okay.
It's a crime to sell.
It's a
crime to distribute. It's a crime to make a copy.
Okay.
In fact, when you buy something that's pirated, in effect, you're the victim.
No.
It's funny, but
even if you're willingly buying something, you know it's not original.
Well, how would you know? Copyright. There is no registry of copyright licenses. We
okay.
don't even know what everything technically is copyrighted.
How would you know? Maybe the price, because they're selling it like for 1/8 of the price.
Sometimes they give things away on the internet. Now, I know what you're saying.
Okay.
I know what you're saying. What
okay.
I'm saying is that IP law or copyright has always been clear that if you are the buyer of fake or pirated goods,
you're not liable. Okay.
So it's the seller is the one who's liable.
Okay.
So I think, I guess there are other issues.
So Mr. Government Official is in the clear?
I think, I don't think he could be held liable for infringement.
Okay, yeah. Very interesting. And I hope if even he or his friends are watching the show, then he'll finally open his phone and take our calls and maybe give his side of the story. You have Attorney J.J. Dicini here, who's on your side. Attorney J.J., thanks for coming to Future Perfect. Right. Hope to see you again on future episodes of the show.
All right, thank you.
Coming up, our favorite gadget guy, Art Samaniego, returns from the most awaited annual electronics fest that is not about Apple. You don't want to miss what he has to share about the 2012 Consumer Electronics Show when Future Perfect returns.